Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.
Good evening. Welcome to Wheels Along the Road here on BCTV, brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. I'm Kendra Cook, and I'm with Dan Olsen.
Oh, hi.
Tonight. Hey, Dan.
Yeah.
we are excited to be here this evening. Looking forward to our show tonight. And before we get to that, give you some information about the Boyertown Museum. The Boyertown Museum is open 7 days a week, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. And if you would like to visit us, you can do that by driving over to see us at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, Pennsylvania. And if you'd like to contact us, you can give us a call 610-367-2090 or visit our website, boyertownmuseum.org. Of course, we also have a very active Facebook page, so check us out on there. We have an Instagram page if you're on that platform, and we also do have a YouTube channel, which is quite active and has lots of stuff. By the way, someone that I know did a YouTube video on the Sun Oil gas station at our museum.
Oh, really?
Yeah, do you know him?
I don't know. Do I?
It was you. Yeah, we had a...
Oh, okay.
Dan forgets
like
already.
Somebody else. Okay.
No, yeah, we just posted a little video there that Dan did on the gas station that's on display in the museum and the pumps out front. So if you want to learn more about that building, go visit our YouTube channel and you can hear all about
it. You're on there too.
I'm on there too, but I'm just the gas pump operator.
You are. Yeah.
You have all the knowledge. I'm just...
Well, we have the knowledge. We're
together.
Teamwork.
That's right.
Stuff. Yeah.
That's right. Give and take. So check us out on there and so many different topics on so many different videos. You'll find something that's interesting to you, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. Now, I did say that we're open 7 days a week, and we are, but we are closed a few major holidays. We just had one of those yesterday, Memorial Day. And I think before I see you again, we'll have another major holiday here, and that's July 4th. So we are closed on Sunday, July 4th. But we're open the day before July 5th and the day after July 5th. So great time to come visit. We were very busy this weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we had over...
Had a lot.
Yeah, we had a lot of people both days. So holiday weekend and it was crummy outside. So they came to visit us. Were you at the museum?
I was there Saturday, yeah.
See, if you go on a Saturday, you might run into this guy. And... And you can ask him a whole bunch of complicated questions about the stuff we have.
Yeah.
So
I'll defer you to Kendra.
I'll get back to you.
Yeah, that's it.
And if you come visit us now, too, we also have our World War II exhibit set up in the lobby that we just opened at the end of May. And if you joined us for that the other weekend, thank you. We had a great turnout for that as well. And... really exciting, and they're really cool vehicles. Two of them have not been on display before. They're new to us, and this is their first time on display. So come see us at the museum, really, is what I'm getting at, is we have lots of cool stuff going on, and that's all in addition to just the really cool cars that we have on exhibit throughout the gallery. So come visit us. I think that with that, we will get to our program this evening. And at this point, I will turn it over to Dan. And what do you have for us tonight?
Plexiglass. And spaghetti. Sorry.
I got a text from Dan this morning, and all it said was plexiglass.
That's what I'm talking about.
And I was with Rod. Rod works at the museum when I got that text. And I said, Dan just said plexiglass. I'm not sure what that means. It took me a moment until I realized.
Sure Rod laughed.
He did. He goes, what?
And then later on, I texted her and spaghetti.
Yes. So I don't know how the two are related, but I'm sure we will find out.
They aren't. I had spaghetti for supper tonight. That's the thing.
I had lasagna.
We're the same family. Before I start talking, okay, you mentioned there was a lot of people there this past weekend, visitors, mm-hmm. okay? The weekend before was the World War II Rosie mm-hmm. the Riveter thing, mm-hmm. and there was a lot of people there, too.
Yep.
And the week prior to that was the Berks County
History Center Road Ramble.
Yeah, and so there was a lot of people who came mm-hmm. who were just interested in history, not necessarily about cars. But the one question, the question that was asked the most on all three weekends, I mean, it wasn't a lot of people asking, but it came up.
Yeah.
And this is the subject I usually bring up to the visitors to bring them back. But this time, they were the ones asking. And I know we don't have an answer to this, or you don't have an answer, but they're asking about our diner day.
Oh.
Okay. And we haven't had it because of this whole COVID and everything mm-hmm. else. But, you know, we're emerging from that. So it's time to get busy
sure
with
hope
diner
so.
Day.
Yeah, we have been asked. Well, especially in the beginning, people asked that a lot. And mm-hmm. I haven't heard it lately. Yeah. But now you're hearing the rumblings. Oh, it'll get to me
thousands
soon.
Thousands of people asked.
It is popular.
Yeah. Yeah,
and fun. It is fun, too.
And I think there was even one or two asked when I was on this tour last Monday, rambling around Lebanon County in the rain.
We've reached out to Lebanon with our pie.
We almost hit a horse. Did I tell you that?
No.
Yeah. I was on a tour a week ago. And I was driving. I was a passenger in 1916 Dodge. We came.
So cool.
There was a horse that was loose in the road.
Not in Lebanon County.
And
I don't believe it.
There was people in another car who was part of this tour, and they were talking about almost hitting a deer. It's like, well, so what? We're in Pennsylvania.
You gotta
expect
that.
A horse is something to write home. Okay. Anyway, enough of that.
Wow.
I was telling Kendra right before we went on air, I'm not sure what prompted me to come up with this subject. And it was probably, usually what happens is I'll see something, I'm reading an article in a car magazine or, you know, in an older car magazine, see an advertisement for some oddball thing.
And you're like, what's that?
Huh?
And you say to yourself, what is that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so that gets me going. And I kind of know what it is, but I didn't, you know, I got 2 pages of notes here, and I'm not sure what prompted it. Anyway, let me start here. If you could show the first picture, please.
Okay.
And this is a company called Midwest General Corporation, and they made a top called Add-A-Top. So you would have a convertible, and you just lower the convertible top and put this on. And I'm sure they had clamps or bolts or something like that. And you can see on the right side a guy standing on the top of it. And it was made out of fiberglass, and I'm hoping it was the structure of it was bolstered so it wouldn't collapse on you.
Especially if you're going to stand on it.
Yeah, you know. And I don't know why he's standing on the roof, though.
I'm sure to prove how strong it is.
Well, yeah.
But
so
not recommended.
That it was molded from laminate fiberglass top. And I'm thinking, if it's laminate, I'm thinking, is that sort of like a plywood idea? So you have the fabric going one way and then the other way, and then, you know, back and forth like that, and gives it strength. $196 for one of those roofs.
Wow.
You can get them for Chevy, Pontiac, Oldsmobile. That's a Ford you're looking at in the picture. Chrysler, Dodge, DeSoto. Change a convertible to hardtop in minutes.
Ooh.
So they were out of Detroit, Michigan. Okay, so that's that. And that was just cool. That was like a free information.
Yeah.
Just put that off to the side here.
Okay, that's a...
Okay, mini. Now we're going to talk about plexiglass.
Plexiglass.
Okay. Acrylic plastic made by a number of manufacturers. Two companies were kind of the biggest in that. And one of them was DuPont Company, who made Lucite, okay? And the other one was Roman Haas out of Philadelphia. There's the Pennsylvania connection. And they were the ones who made Plexiglass. They were the largest producer. And I saw somewhere Plexiglass is like a household name. Yeah, household term, like Kleenex and ping pong balls. And, you know, there's other ones. And they say, this is kind of neat, Roman Haas, which is R-O-H-M and H-A-A-S, Roman Haas.
Very German.
Yeah, it came up with a phrase called never lose sight of plexiglass. And lose sight is L-U-C-I-T-E, which is a DuPont. And kind of clever thing. Okay, so anyway, they made the plexiglass. So manufacturers of plexiglass or Lucite products, I'm not sure. There was one company called Cadillac Plastics out in Troy, Michigan, started buying surplus airplane canopies. They somehow applied heat to the canopies and flattened them out, which sounds kind of weird. I think they would lose some of their qualities. Anyway, they became one of the world's largest distributors and fabricators of plastic sheet, rod, tube, and film. They went through various mergers and buyouts and stuff, and ended up part of GE, General Electric, and then sold to another company in Saudi Arabia. Now they're back an independent company down in North Carolina. So they apparently made some car parts with plexiglass. I'm not sure, or Lucite. I'm not sure about that either. There's a company out there called Wright Austin out of Detroit, made bubble tops for cars in the early 50s. They, I can't find anything about that. I just saw a line item, okay? This isn't going good so far, but wait. Early Corvettes, the first style of Corvettes, I'm thinking all the straight axles up in the early 60s. You could get a top for them that was made like a bubble top, like clear plastic.
Yeah.
So I've seen pictures of them. They're quite rare from what I understand.
Sounds like a George Jetson theme.
George Jetson, yeah.
Yeah.
And then for you custom car people out there and model builders from way back, there was Big Daddy Ed Roth, who had a lot of bubble tops on his cars. Over the seating area. Okay, so he's kind of, that was one of his trademarks. Okay, next picture here. These are probably the most famous vehicles with plexiglass tops. That is a 1954 Ford Crestline Skyliner, okay? And you can see the roof. The roof is actually painted white, but you see the center, or the part in the, right above the front seat, and that's plexiglass. It was tinted green. Go to the next picture. Wow. You're going to see a 55 Ford. You can't see it as clear, but that has the same kind of roof. Go to the following picture, and we're seeing a 1954 Mercury. So Fords and Mercuries between 54 and 56 had them. The Mercuries were called the Sun Valley. Ooh. And that's neat. You know, it's sunny,
I like that.
Sunny car, Sun Valley. Get it?
Yeah. So that was a ski resort.
Yeah, which
in Idaho?
Somewhere out there. It probably still is.
It was on an episode of the Lucy and Desi Comedy Hour.
Oh boy. Okay. You go to the next picture. There's that's a 55 Mercury and Sun Valley. And you know, they said these cars were hot. And you would bake, even with the tinted glass. And you can't see it really well, but on the rear quarter panel, the rear fender, there's some vents there. And that has air conditioning, which on a Mercury is probably quite rare. So,
really?
Yeah. So today, there's cars with clear tops. I don't know what they are, but once in a while, I'll see a picture of one or actually see one on the road, and I think almost the whole top is. We've had sunroofs and moonroofs for a long time. I had a sunroof on a car, and I thought, I didn't like it at all.
Really?
Because it was, like, behind me.
Oh.
The only way I knew it was there, it would be noisy if I opened it up.
The thing I like about them is when it's raining and you hear that.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's a better sound to me.
Puts you to sleep.
Probably not good, though, if I'm driving, I guess,
no.
Right? Yeah.
Okay. So, let's talk about Roman Haas.
All right.
Out of Philadelphia, they started in 1909. Originally, actually, they were in Philadelphia in 1909. They started as a German company starting in 1901. So there's your German name.
It was on the German names.
And they established U.S. branch in 09. They started as a chemical firm manufacturing leather stuff for the leather industry, and a lot of that leather was sold to auto companies and coach builders and that sort of thing. They're the ones who developed, patent, and manufactured Plexiglass, the world's first transparent acrylic sheet product. And they did that from working with laminated safety glass. So in 1936, they invented the Plexiglass acrylic, and it was just in time for World War II, okay? I don't know if they got an E-flag for that.
We need to look them up.
Correct.
All right.
Okay. Numerous applications during the war, bomber noses, canopies, gun turrets and stuff, in the military thing. It was tough, didn't shatter like glass, had near-perfect optics, and did not degrade from sunlight. So that was pretty good stuff there. There was other companies that also made acrylic products for wartime use. So, end of the war comes. What are you going to do with this fantastic material, okay? You try to come up with new markets. So they came up with taillight lenses and parking light lenses, which
okay.
I think it's a good idea,
yeah.
But still I'm thinking you could do a lot more than that.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of stuff. So they struggled. They didn't really struggle long. They became a leading manufacturer of the Plexiglass, or the acrylic material here. Roman Haas now... well, not now, but more current times, it became one of the world's largest manufacturers of specialty chemicals. Supplies paint, powder coatings, and adhesives to the auto industry. 1990, sold their Plexiglass business. And in 1908, Roman Haas was acquired by Dow Chemical Company and no longer exists.
Oh,
so,
got eaten up.
Yeah, sort of got eaten up, okay.
But they were in Philly.
Yeah, they
That's
were
crazy.
In Philly.
All
okay.
that was going on in Philly.
Now, here we go, page 2. Plexiglass users. And so there was a company in Byesville, Ohio, which is nothing little thing. You look at the name of the town. Okay, you got my notes. And you can see the name of the town.
It is Byesville.
The name looks like a little town, right? Yeah. Okay. Anyway, they had a company there called Fabriform, and they got this acrylic stuff, Plexiglass, from Roman Haas, and then they would heat it up and manufacture different things. They were a pioneer in the field of thick sheet thermoforming, which heating it up and forming, bending it,
yeah,
okay?
Yeah, I guess, yeah.
Their initial focus was on the aircraft industry. Made acrylic canopies for World War II bombers. So, you know, I mentioned that earlier that the Plexiglass is used for the the military aircraft. So there it is. So after World War II, they came up with a Plexiglass bubble for automobiles. And so you could show the next picture there. Okay. And it's kind of small there, but that first car, thank you, control person.
You can see through it.
Yeah. It looks dirty.
It does.
It looks like the windows of my car. Yeah. So anyway, you can see through that. And I believe that's a pre-war Cadillac, but you know, I'm looking next to it. There's a post-war Mercury. So, you know, we're thinking after a war. So they, that was called full view plexiglass bubble top. So full view, obviously you can see all around and stuff. Rumor has it also that Roman Haas manufactured clear plexiglass bubble tops for 46 through 1948 Fords. Also Buicks and others. Okay, so if they did it for Buicks, it would probably fit the same, it probably the same dimensions as a Cadillac there. I don't know. There was also a prototype plexiglass top made for a 1946 Ford Deluxe convertible from quarter-inch thick clear sheet. Okay, that was made by the Fabriform company out of Bysville, Ohio. And few were sold, probably because such canopies trapped a lot of solar heat inside during sunny days. Now, we were looking at this Fords and Mercurys before. That was only half the top of the roof.
And it was tinted.
It was tinted, and there was problems. Here, these, actually, you show the next picture, and you can see really easy how clear it was.
I mean, that is a great photo.
Yeah. So.
Hey, that seat is plaid.
You saw that, too. Okay. Okay. So, This is kind of interesting. So that's one of those Fords, a 46-48 Ford. It has a license plate on it, 1947. So there you go. And it was interesting. I found this online. And also, they had a picture of the back of, or there was an image of the back of this picture. And on it, I'm going to read what I have here. And it was like taped to it, you know, it was in color, it'd be all yellowed and stuff.
Yeah.
But it's called Auto Bubbles, Los Angeles. Glass tops for convertibles similar to the blisters and bubbles made by the same company for warplanes have been introduced in Los Angeles. The tops fasten at the same points as a regular canvas tops and are easily removed for storage in the family garage. Though colorless at this time, a choice of tints is planned for the future. The tops are said to be easy to clean and that scratches on the surface of the quarter-inch plexiglass can be removed by polishing with auto polish or wax. Made by Fabriform Corporation of Ohio, they are being distributed by a local Ford agency. Shown here in a convertible equipped with a full-view top, are Wilda Eggert, Val Eklot, Jim Dupuy, and Sally Hamblin, all of the auto agency. I should have looked those names up.
Wilda. That's great.
Wilda
Eggert. I wonder which one's Wilda.
Wait a minute. Okay, she's in the front. Yeah, driver's seat. That's Wilda. Wilda, if you're watching, give us a call.
Please do.
Okay.
I love that photo.
So anyway, so that's Fabriform, what they were doing. Obviously, that did not go too far with those things.
No.
But they stayed in business. They later supplied inner door liners for General Electric refrigerators.
Okay.
Military visors for aircraft helmets, including, but also the visor worn on John Glenn's helmet when he first orbited the Earth on February 20th, 1962. So there.
They left the planet.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Okay. So that's kind of plexiglass stuff. They, and I have that in quote marks, it's who's they,
who's,
you know?
The mysterious they.
Actually, they said the press, and I changed it to they. But same people, okay?
Yes.
Predicted all cars would soon have transparent plexiglass bubble roofs for all around visibility. Okay.
They're a little off.
And I saw that online. It was part of some little article. And the next line said, we were also told that we would live in dome cities with climate control. So we're kind of getting that way. Yeah.
That's how it had to be on Mars.
Mars, okay. And the next line. Our second car would be a small commuter helicopter with bubble windshield and canopy. Then it said, and I'm thinking this was like like 1950s, maybe 60s, because the last thing is domes reached a peak with the introduction of the Cone of Silence on Get Smart in 1965. I knew I had to put
great
that in for
show.
You.
Yeah. One of my favorites.
The Cone of Silence.
Thank you.
Okay. Kind of reminds me of David. Remember from the museum? Yeah, his kind of sign. Okay, so Roman Haas actually had cars made. They had these five vehicles called the Explorer vehicles that they made starting in 1963. I don't know how many years they were in existence, but you know, one was a modified Corvair, one was based on a 64 Corvette, one was based on a Mustang, and they kind of customized it, just showing possible uses for their material here. None of those cars exist. They were all destroyed in a warehouse fire. Probably just big blob melted.
Yeah, really.
But
it smelled horrible.
Show the next picture. And there we go.
Look at that crazy.
Okay. That started out as a 1939 Pontiac there. GM, General Motors, requested Roman Haas quote on constructing bodies for these cars. There was two Pontiacs in 1939. But I read conflicting things. Before finishing their quote, General Motors decided to build them in-house. Now, I don't know how General Motors would build something like that. But anyway, so it's at Fisher Body. So the whole body is made in plexiglass, and you can go to the next picture. You can kind of flip back and forth because it's the same vehicle there. And so they did that car, and then there was another one. The other one that does not exist, has never been found. It might be in somebody's garage here in Reading. Was constructed for the 1940 Golden Gate Exposition in San Francisco. This one that we're looking at was made, it was shown at the General Motors Highways and Horizons Pavilion at the 1939-1940 New York World's Fair. And I'm thinking that's World's Fair stuff.
That is, yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty neat. So anyway, this car here was built in 1939, then modified at Fisher Body with a 1940 front end. It shows it with the 1940 front end here. It reportedly cost $25,000 to build, which I don't know what that is in today.
1939. Yeah. That's a lot of money.
Yeah.
They weren't messing around.
So once they closed the exposition and the World's Fair, the cars toured on different dealerships. this car ended up in Smithsonian Institution until 1947. Then it was later owned by several Pontiac dealers in Pennsylvania. And then after that, it went to private owners. So it was a running car. They could drive it around. And I read about the mileage on it. This was sold at an auction 10 years ago, and the mileage was like 800 miles. Maybe it was a lot less than that. But, you know, so it only drove around a little bit. And if you take a look at it, the tires are white, and the running board's white, too. So they call this the ghost car, which kind of works.
Why would they give it white tires? Just for looks?
I think for looks, yeah. So, yeah.
Ghost car.
And I've talked to somebody who owned that car, not recently. I've talked to him, and I thought of contacting him for this, but it was quite a while ago when he did own it. And I figured, that was
there's two of those.
Interesting. There was. One of them is lost somewhere.
In Berks County.
Who knows? Who knows?
If you have it, let us know.
Yeah.
Wow.
It might be owned by Wilda Eggert.
That Wilda. She's Wiley or something.
Okay. And that's what I have.
Wow.
That was plexiglass.
I would not have guessed any of that from the text I got this morning. So.
Yep. Stump Kendra.
That's right. I was stumped. That's for sure. I was really stumped last week because my original idea for tonight got too big. So I think Dan and I are going to come back at a later date and work on it together because I think it demands an extra brain. Mm-hmm. I can't. I need another head on this one.
Not really an extra, but there's so much stuff that we could collaborate and spend the whole time just talking about the one subject.
It's interesting. So I'm not sure what inspired me for tonight. I'll be like you. I really don't know. But
Not spaghetti sauce.
It was not spaghetti sauce, however, or the spaghetti itself.
Right, with noodles.
I'm going to go a little earlier than you did tonight, and I'm going to go back to the 19-teens and 20s and talk a little bit about a fad, the cycle car fad.
Okay.
So I'll put up the first picture there. This is a Bedelia.
Sounds like a flower.
It does. It makes me think of my kids' books called Amelia Bedelia, which they're really annoying books, to be honest with you. But I will not let that reflect on my opinion of this car. But anyway, I just put that up there so you can kind of see what a cycle car is. So what were they? They were supposed to be a lightweight, no-frills car. Okay? Geez, it sounds like my little orange car out there in the parking lot. Mm-hmm. Lightweight, no frills. inexpensive, which is where the no-frills things comes in. And really, almost like a halfway point between a motorcycle and a car. These are really supposed to be very tiny. This is, you can see that guy is sitting behind, actually, the guy in the back is the driver.
Okay. And it is only a two-seater, correct?
And it's only a two-seater. Yep. And this was one way that they tried to make the cars smaller, you know, like the tread smaller, you know, to seat the people. Not all of them are like this, but in this case, that was one way of doing it, was to seat the people behind the other. So anyway, that's a Bedelia. Now, there was a group called the American Cycle Car Manufacturers Association, and they came up with a definition for a cycle car when they first met in 1914. And it was, quote, a four-wheeled vehicle with an engine displacement not to exceed 71 cubic inches. So it's a pretty small car. The definition does kind of become more flexible and change a little bit over time, especially as more of these manufacturers sort of crop up. And in fact, not long after that, they add that light car should be incorporated as part of that definition. And that was just the next year, 1915. But so typically what you have here are one or two cylinder engines, and Spackey out of Indianapolis was a big supplier of these engines. Does that engine look familiar to you, Dan?
It sure does.
It sure does. We have an engine like this at the museum. I believe we have two. We have one on a stand.
Okay.
And then we have a second type like this, I believe, in the gem. We have two gems. These are Duryea gems, and they actually have different engines.
Yeah.
And I forget which one's out now.
I'm thinking the one in storage.
Is like this one?
It's the Spackey, I think. But whatever, the gem is a good example of a cycle car.
The GEM is a type of cycle car. And even I think Duryea even wrote in his literature for that it was a motorcycle hybrid or something. I think he put in there. So the GEM is from 1917. And that's on display at the museum. I actually don't have a photo of it with me tonight. I have another car of ours that represented here later. But yeah, the GEM would have been kind of considered in this. And he advertised for that, you know, the ease of even one person to flip it over onto its side and make a repair. Mm-hmm. So these are really lightweight vehicles. So yeah, Spackey was out of Indianapolis, and this was a market for them. This is they did a lot of motorcycle engines too. You'll see this type of engine on a lot of motorcycles at the time. They are often chain or belt driven, as a way to avoid using a conventional differential. And actually, in that first photo, that Bedelia, I don't know if you noticed, there was a big chain. Mm-hmm. There on the car. The bodywork on them was often very minimal.
Good word.
Yeah, minimal is a good word. And these are bare bones. They don't really worry about kind of safety protection or anything for the driver or the passengers or passenger. Usually you're not going to fit more than two people in these. And they do this for a couple reasons. One, it cuts down on the cost. Again, these are no frills. Even today, you know, go look at a car and get something with no add-ons, and that's the base price. The more you add on, the more it's going to cost. It's also to keep down the weight of the car. That was really important. So June of 1914, this photo, the caption on this, I didn't put that caption on. It came with this. That says July. The article I saw was June. So I don't actually know which is accurate. But there was a little, there was a periodical that came out. I know Dan uses the trade journals and stuff a lot from this time period. I was reading one called Carette.
I've heard of that.
Carette.
And it's all dedicated
and
to these little things.
All this kind of stuff. So according to Carette, in June of 1914, the first light car competitive event was held in America. A 48-mile run from Newark to Teaneck in which all the competing cars participated without any trouble and at an 18-mile-per-hour pace. That's not fast. 48-mile run, if you're going at 18 miles per hour the whole time, which you weren't, you wouldn't be, but if you were, that would be like a 2.5 hours to go 48 miles.
Something like that.
It took longer than that. 18 miles per hour is the average. So they had a hill climb, a reverse gear race, a slow race, and a 2-mile secret time event.
Mm-hmm.
New Jersey was really into this, it seemed. Anyway, September 5th, 6th, and 7th, a successful 3-day reliability run for light cars was promoted by the New Jersey Light Car Club from Newark to Atlantic City and return a distance of 300 miles. This event was the largest and most grueling road contest ever run in America for small cars. 4 out of 12 finished with perfect mechanical score and 1 with perfect tire score. I'm not sure what a tire score is. They averaged, these cars averaged over 35 miles per gallon on this. But think, it took 3 days to go 300 miles.
Well, they...
And the roads were bad, too. I mean, that's
they
worked
at Atlantic City. They probably stayed there a couple days. But it's interesting because... between Newark and Atlantic City, it's flat. And I'm wondering, you know, was that part of the thing?
That, too. I'm sure that helped.
Yeah. Because I don't think the cars were that powerful.
No,
except
they were not.
The Newark to Teaneck, you mentioned something about
said
a hill there.
Was a hill climb, but I don't have detailed results of this.
And how big of a hill was it?
Yeah, really. this was another one that mentioned in this 1914 Carrette issue. One of the novel events staged during 1914, and this was like an annual report of just the, I guess, this American Cycle Car Manufacturers Association meeting. One of the novel events staged during 1914 was the Darkness to Dawn competitive run from New York to Boston on October 8th. The distance was 250 miles, and two cars, a Coey and a Zip, came through with a perfect score in 15 hours. What's New York to Boston now? What is that, like a four-hour trip? Maybe? So 15 hours?
I don't know why anybody'd want to go to Boston.
Says the Yankees fan.
Sorry.
But yeah, I'd like that Darkness to Dawn thing. Mm-hmm. That would be interesting. I can't remember how they saw. I mean, there's not like street lights and things like we're thinking. The headlights were terrible. I'm fairly curious about that one. Anyway, so in general, the cycle cars aren't terribly popular here. I mean, there's a craze, and I'll throw some makes out here in a little bit. But they're more popular in Europe. One of the reasons is because in Europe, the taxes on the registrations and licenses, it's like a sliding scale based on how big the engine is and how much the car weighs. So obviously, it's going to be cheaper for a little car like this than it would be for something bigger. These fees don't differ in the United States. It's one flat fee, so that's not really a selling point for them over here. And also, I didn't think of this too. You know, in Europe, you go shorter distances. You know, your countries are very tiny over there. Mm-hmm. Out here, you know, you drive 3 hours and you could be in a different state, you know. So, or you could stay, be in the same state. In Europe, that's...
You'd be three countries
away. Yeah, you're in the next country already. So, that's another reason they're a little more popular here. They also are not the most, they're a little flimsy, we'll say that. Mm-hmm. The construction's a little flimsy, but that was the intention. It was supposed to be a cheaper car for people, and they don't really last too long. The roads are really rough, so that's hard on them, and the frames are often done in pine or fir, so very soft wood, and... they're just not built to last. And that's why we don't really have a lot of great examples of them today even. Some of the companies, here's one, Woods Mobilette. There's that cut, cropped a little bit. It will carry two at about the price of one car fare. So, and they're talking about, you know, why get on a streetcar when you can get in this little car? But here's from, now these guys were out of Harvey, Illinois, but here's a creative suggestion for those who did not own a garage to keep their car. This is from sales literature of theirs. Get some rough lumber and build a box 4.5 feet high, 3.5 feet wide, and 8.5 or 9 feet long with a door at one end. Into this box, the car can be placed and locked up safe from storms, thieves, etc. Just build a box in your yard.
Interesting.
But again, you know, again, these are people, they are marketing to people who maybe don't necessarily have a garage.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, these are cheap cars. Someone with a lot of money is going to go out and buy, you know, a Pierce Arrow or an electric car or something.
Right.
They probably have a garage to keep them in. There is an overhead shot of one called a Dudley Bug. And I don't know if you can tell too well here. So you got the driver's seat. You can sort of see that line coming out perpendicular from the side of the car. That's the back of the seat. But then look at where the passenger sits. The passenger sits staggered. They're all the way. Their seat back is the back of the car itself.
So you can, sitting next to each other, your shoulders would be
into each other. The passenger's knees are kind of up at the driver's side, shoulders. It's very strange. But they also, so they had some strange seating arrangements. They also liked some of these kind of cutesy names, like there's the Dudley Bug.
Mm-hmm. And the Zip.
The Zip. Look at that.
Is that the Zip there?
Yeah, there's the Zip. He won that one race back then.
Mm-hmm.
And here's the Oh We Go.
From Oh We Go, New York.
Isn't that great?
Yeah. There's a car like that in a museum in New York. I've seen it. And it's a little, it's the size of this
it's tiny
table, I think.
That's one that illustration right there, you can really see like the chain drive there on the side.
Mm-hmm.
And that is another one of those the passenger sits in the back behind the driver. That is an imp.
Imp.
Which is a very distinctive looking thing. It's very long. That's got the big long, that's a belt on this one. They were built in Auburn. Can you imagine? Same city is putting out Auburns and cords and then this.
Oh, that Auburn. Yeah. Okay. Wow.
That's another really tiny one. That's a princess out of Detroit. So, these cute little pretty names. We talked a little about the gem that's at the museum, but we also have a Hanover.
Okay.
Hanover was kind of getting in here at the tail end of this craze, and that didn't really help it. So the Hanover Motor Car Company is out of Hanover, Pennsylvania. And historian Beverly Ray Kimes said about the Hanover, the Hanover arrived about a half decade after the cycle car debacle in the United States and was what the cycle car should have been all along. Which, it's pretty high praise, mm-hmm. actually. Their timing was poor. But her argument was this is kind of basically what cycle cars should have been mm-hmm. more like. Now, they built cars from 1921 to 1927. Ours is a 1921, so it's one of the first models that came. It was only $345. So that's about $4,600 or so in today's money. Hanover did at one point purchase a factory in Buffalo, New York, and they did have plans to move production all up to New York State. But that never seems to have panned out. It seems like they tried to leave Pennsylvania or expand or whatever, but they never did. They stayed and built everything in Hanover. So one of the things about the Hanover is that you could purchase this car with either right or left hand steering. And this was because Hanover really wanted to export their cars. You know, they... In a way, I think they kind of knew that this was dead here in the United States, but saw that outside of the country, these types of cars were more popular. And actually, most Hanovers, they sold better in Japan than they did here in the United States.
Hmm.
They truly believed, according to their sales literature, the car of the future will be a lightweight car. There's it from the front. Sorry, the lighting. There's a really enormous Chrysler behind me when I'm taking this photo, and I couldn't back up anymore. But there it is from the front. Maybe they were right about that, but it was a lot more into the future, I think, than they realized. They did have some problems with technically. The brakes, I've read, were not good on these cars. They also had the gas tank on top of the radiator. So the fuel filler cap is where most people would normally expect the radiator cap to be, to put water in. That caused a lot of confusion.
I guess it would.
Bad things happen when you pour water in your gas tank.
Mm-hmm.
So It weighed 850 pounds, had a 10-inch diameter flywheel, 50 miles per gallon, had two speeds forward, one reverse. It's just a 90-inch wheelbase. So it's a tiny little thing. That's just an inside shot of the car. You can see the seat is not large at all. I think it is a two-passenger, but they'd have to be small people to fit two people in there nicely. So guess who doesn't like the cycle car craze?
Henry Ford.
Yeah, our good buddy Henry Ford isn't really a fan of the cycle cars. Of course, he's making Model Ts that are supposed to be inexpensive and for anybody that wants to afford them. So he kind of sees these as a threat to what he's trying to do. So what our good pal Henry Ford does is he goes out and he builds a Model T that's like a 3/4 size Model T. And he uses a wooden frame, a smaller two bearing version of the Model T engine, which is right there. And I think he only built one, and it was driven around kind of prominently around the town, around Detroit. You know, we talked a few weeks ago about Packard Proving Grounds and how when car makers were coming out with new stuff, they wanted proving grounds to try them out because they didn't want people to kind of get wind of the next hot thing coming off the assembly line. Well, he didn't do this with this car. He drove it around pretty prominently. And it caused quite a stir, and a lot of people started to think that Ford was going to enter the cycle car market. He didn't deny that or confirm it. He just kind of let it go. And a lot of investors out there pulled their money out of other cycle car companies because how are they ever going to compete with Henry Ford? So that didn't help the cycle car.
He probably didn't want to build it at all.
Oh, I know. He had no intentions.
That's why he's driving around the streets.
Exactly,
and stuff, yeah.
Exactly. He was kind of
slick.
He was very slick, like threatening. Like, you think you're going to build a better car than me? I don't think so. So, but it scared enough people, you know. There's just no way to kind of tangle with him. So that's a little about the cycle car craze. We talked about, we do have two, I think, pretty good examples of this at the museum, the Hanover I showed you and the Gem. So you have to come check them out. We have some lightweight stuff. The Dial is like on the edge.
Yeah, I've heard
it's
arguments.
More of a lightweight.
Yeah, light car.
Yeah.
I remember somebody, another Dial owner, having that discussion.
Yeah, and that was built right here in Reading.
Yep.
So.
Yep.
If you take their further expansions on the definition where they add the term light car, then we could put the Dial in here. So come to the museum and see those little teeny tiny cars. And that's the cycle car craze. We're probably don't have time for a car quiz, do we? I'm sorry.
we're ready for next time.
We are ready for next time. And that was Bubble Tops.
Mm-hmm.
And
cycle cars,
fads, one and all. Do you think the bubble top mainly failed because of the heat?
I think so.
Do you think that was the big thing? Because it looks really cool.
Yeah. I mean, it works with the Jetsons, but
I love the space age, like, vibe to it. Mm-hmm. Like,
yeah, I was going to have pictures of, like, Big Daddy Ed Roth's, a couple of his in there too, and I thought, I'll just mention it because his was, you know, these really weird looking, futuristic,
so cool,
Mysterion, and I forget some of the others now. Cyclops was one, I forget now. He had a bunch of Tweety Bird. Yeah, it doesn't make
Tweety
any
Bird
difference.
Is the yellow Warner Brothers.
Yeah.
Cartoon. Yeah, I always I always wonder why these things don't catch on.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe they leaked too.
Yeah, well, people like their privacy, and you don't get it with that.
This is true. Yeah. But Wilda's okay with it. And if Wilda's all right with it, I'm all right with it. So, yeah, thank you, everyone, for joining us tonight. And we will return in July for another episode. And I have no idea what we're going to talk about then. I don't know if we'll have enough, if we'll be able to get our heads wrapped around that other topic. We'll see.
I'm all ready. I could do it right now.
Show off.
Not about that something, but...
Well, you got your car quiz ready. So come back and come see us in July. Remember that the museum is open 7 days a week, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. We are closed July 4th, but other than that, we are open. We're ready to see you, and we're excited to start seeing more people now that hopefully we're getting rid of this COVID thing, and it's nice to see more people in the museum and enjoying themselves. So come visit us. If you have more questions, contact us at the museum. And without further ado, we will see you next month. And everyone be safe.
Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.